14, 2015 work session. We welcome all of our invited guests and elected officials. See our Sheriff Gary Gullidge, Mayor Doris Debbie in the back. Any other elected officials? Thank you all for being here. Remind you to turn off all cell phones, next tells and pagers or silence them. Marshall, if you have any wishes to speak. This morning for our invocation and pledge, we have Pastor Thomas Dixon, the Associate Pastor of the New Genesis Church at Austell and Chaplain of the Hiram High School football team. Would you come forward and bring your invocation and pledge? Would you stand with me if you're able?
Let us pray. Most gracious Father, we come to you this morning as humble as we know how, giving you the honor, the praise, and the glory. God, please forgive us for our sins and our shortcomings, and we thank you for our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And Father, I pray that your divine favor will fall upon this meeting today and on each commissioner that is present. Bless them with your wisdom, knowledge, and power as they make decisions for this county. Lord, bless every family represented here today. Bless Paulden County as it grows, because we know that all power rests in your hands alone. May your presence always reside with this Board of Commissioners, and may your presence always reside with Paulden County. Father, thank you for this day, and for this hour, and for this moment. Please watch over us and keep us until we see each other again. And Father, before we end this prayer, we pray that you would just bless Connie Prater today, Father. We ask that you will be with her in the time of her bereavement. Give her strength, guidance, and direction as she go on. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Pastor, that was a beautiful prayer. There's a lot of people to think about. I will get the gentleman's name, but we had people that helped put out our flags, and one of them fell out of the back of the truck and eventually died. And so I will remember that family, because he was out trying to help us celebrate our independence by helping put out the flags. Great loss. Remember Reverend Curtis Turner, if you would, in your prayers. Curtis has gone through a pretty rough surgery at Emory to have a hernia removed that had encased his organs. And he's a dear pastor friend here in Paulden County, Sheriff Gullidge's former pastor, and just a great man. And he's undergoing this terrible surgery and recovering. And they gave him a 15% chance of coming off the operation, and he did. So if y'all would, let's lift him up and keep him in our prayers, and always for our veterans. The minutes, the June 23rd, 2015 work session minutes and the June 23rd, 2015 board meeting minutes are available for your review. There are no announcements, invited guests. We have Blake Swofford, the director of Paul in Northwest Atlanta Airport, to give an airport update per the intergovernmental agreement. Blake, would you come forward?
Good morning.
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 Well, I'm back.
Thank you.
I know y'all thought you'd gotten rid of me, but here I am again. I'm here today to give you an update based on the intergovernmental agreement that was signed last year in the fall of 2014. That intergovernmental agreement provided funding from the Board of Commissioners to the Paulding County Airport Authority. And as part of the commitment and requirement to the Airport Authority, we are to give you an annual overview of essentially how that money was spent. So that's what I'm here to do today. The handout that I've just given you is the complete overview of the FY15 budget. It does include all revenues to the Airport Authority, not just the revenues from the county. So as you'll see, I'll start at the top and go down through this. I'm not going to go line by line because I don't want to put you to sleep or everyone else in the audience here. But I will hit the highlights. On the revenue side, you have airport rental income, fuel flowage fees, government funding, which is the funding from the county, ground lease, housing rental income, IBA funding, and tie-down lease income. And as you can see, the first two columns are really those that you want to focus your attention on. What was budgeted was a little bit over $460,000. What was collected was $455,000. So we're about 1%, just a tad bit over 1% off on revenues from budgeted to actual. And those primarily fell in two categories. One is the fuel flowage fee. We did not sell quite as much fuel in FY15 as we did in FY14. However, those numbers can flux a little bit, and what I mean by that is we did have a fuel delivery on July 7th, so we had a fuel delivery 7 days after the end of this fiscal year, so certainly most of those fuel sales were contributed in 2015, but they won't go on the budget until 2016, so those numbers do flux. And then we're off a little bit on house rental income, and that's simply because the house that's owned by the Airport Authority that's rented out, we had a changeover in tenants during FY15, and whenever we have a changeover in tenants, we typically go in and do a good bit of maintenance to make sure the house is in good shape and we don't have any issues of any kind. So it took us about 6 weeks to get all of our maintenance done, so we lost 2 months of rental income on the house, but do have folks in there now, and rental income is coming in. Going on down to the expense column, I'm just going to hit some highlights of some things that I'd like to call to your attention. I'm not going to go line by line. The second item is airfield maintenance. You can see that the airfield maintenance is well over what was anticipated and what was budgeted. We had two lightning strikes last year in FY15. One of them on the runway, which took out, made some large holes in the runway, and also took out a lot of our lights, and one on some electrical equipment on the airfield. So we had a substantial amount of damage last year from those two lightning strikes, so this is not regular scheduled airfield maintenance that was missed as far as the budget is concerned. These are items that couldn't be foreseen. Can't really predict where lightning's going to hit. But later, as we get down towards the bottom, I'll show you where that was offset with some insurance, so at least we didn't have to buy off that whole thing. Insurance did take care of some of it. Moving on down, you'll see that we were over budget on a few items, such as marketing and website. The changeover from the Airport Authority shutting, or I should say the Airport Department shutting down and the Airport Authority starting up, required us to do some things that that aren't regular budget items, and I'll explain that. For example, our email, prior to October of last year, the county employees, the airport department employees were on county email. So there was no expense associated with that. However, when we switched everything over to the Airport Authority and the employees became employees of the Airport Authority, at that point we had to set up email service. So we had to set up a service and get that started and start paying for that email service. So there's some things like that that weren't anticipated in the FY15 budget, when the FY15 budget was submitted, which would have been, you know, June, July time frame of last year. So there are some things like that which did cause some line items to go over. Going on down through the budget, one thing I do want to talk about just a little bit is down under professional fees. You can see that our accounting fees are pretty much what they were projected to be. Engineering fees were a little higher than what they were projected to be, and legal fees were a tad bit lower than what they were expected to be. In a typical year, we would normally see about $25,000 in legal fees Everybody knows what's going on with the airport. I don't need to explain that to you, but just want to call it to your attention that these legal fees are greatly higher than what we typically see in a normal year with the airport. So hopefully at some point in time in the future, these will go back down, but I don't pretend to know when that'll be. If you look at the very bottom of the page, you'll see total expenses projected at $458,000 and total expenses at $481,000. Primarily, that was due to two things that I've already mentioned to you. One of them was the airfield maintenance being much higher than anticipated because of the two lightning strikes, and the other was because of those startup fees that I mentioned to you. When we switched things over from the county to the airport authority, there were a fair amount of startup fees. Another example I'll give you is telephones. The telephones that we were using out at the airport belonged to Paulding County. They were tied into Paulding County's phone system. So those phones had to come out. We had to get a new phone service set up, which meant that we had to buy telephones. So things like that, which did put us over budget on our expenditures. Flipping real quickly to page two, you'll see that we did have some other incomes which did offset our overage in our expenses, namely the insurance claim, which I mentioned earlier were from the lightning strike. We had some open records request fees and the reimbursement expenses. Those reimbursement expenses came from the contract which we have with Propeller Investments, which they do fund some of our engineering work at the airport. We have a contract that requires them to partner with us on funding some of the engineering work. So that was reimbursement from some of that engineering work that's done at the airport. So very bottom line, at the end of page two, net income for FY15, a little over $2,000 over, which meant that had to come out of what little bit of reserves we had from FY14. And we're hopeful moving forward in FY16 that those one-time costs that were associated with switching things over to the airport authority, obviously those won't reoccur again. And we certainly hope to generate some new revenues in FY16. If anybody's got any questions about any of these items, income or expense, I'd be glad to speak to them in more detail if you'd like.
Thank you, Blake. I got it. Question one, if you could send this to board commissioners electronically.
Absolutely.
Because I know as soon as the meeting's over, there's going to be people asking for it.
Sir.
That'll make it simple for me.
Yep.
I feel like probably most everything's on here is pretty self-explanatory. Up under expenses, you have leased employee.
Yes.
Could you explain that? Because I think that's probably going to be a question that I'm going to get, and I just don't have the answer now.
Absolutely. I'm glad to explain that. When we switched from airport department to airport authority, of course, all of you are aware that Jeannie Walton had previously been my assistant. She stayed with the county. She did not go over to the airport authority. So I had to hire a new assistant, who is Yolanda Newell. I think all of you know Yolanda. She came over to me from the Economic Development Department. When I hired Yolanda, a couple of things that we had to do that we've not previously had to deal with, primarily benefits. The Airport Authority did not have any employees previously, so there were no benefits, no health benefits, no retirement benefits, no insurance of any kind. So when we started looking at putting those benefits together, Yolanda had previously been employed by the Chamber of Commerce, and she went to work for the Economic Development Department under a contract between the Economic Development Department and the Chamber of Commerce. So she was a leased employee from the Chamber to the EDO. When she explained to me why they did that, how they did that, and I looked at the contract and everything, it made the most sense because the chamber already had all of her benefits in place. She already had her health insurance, her dental insurance, her life insurance. All of that was already in place. So there was really no benefit and no reason for me to require her to change all of that. Actually, it would have been more expensive if we had had to start up those benefits than it was for her to keep her benefits with the chamber. So essentially what we did was the exact same thing as what the EDO had done. We did a contract with the Chamber of Commerce to utilize the alarm at the airport. So that's termed a lease employee. And you'll see in a line item directly above that, that employee benefits, the budget was 35 and the actual was 19. And part of that 29,000 actually is her benefits. So it's salary and benefits. But there's not really a way for me to break that out. So as we move forward in FY16, this budget won't look like this. It'll be set up differently. But what we had to do this year, because half of the year or a portion of the year, we operated under a county budget as an airport department. And then the rest of the year, we operated under the airport authority as an airport authority budget. We had to take the two budgets and we had to stick them together, which is why this thing is as long as it is. And there's some things that kind of overlap. So we will kind of reinvent the wheel in FY16. This budget will be simplified and it will look a little bit different than it does right now. But that's the reason those items are in there the way that they are. Does that make sense? Did I explain that?
Okay. Yeah, because I know that's going to be a question that once somebody looks at this, they're going to ask.
Sure.
And then your payroll expenses are a little bit lower than your budgeted, and that, and actually that's from the leased employee, because that's
exactly
on a different line along with the employee benefits.
That's exactly right. So that leased employee amount, part of that would go into payroll, the other part would go into benefits,
right,
if you broke that apart.
Okay.
So we will show that differently moving forward so that it is easier to follow. Thank you for asking that question.
Any other questions? Thank you, Blake.
Thank you.
Bid awards, discuss action to award the turn lane addition at Burnt Hickory Elementary School project to the low bidder, J&W Concrete and Asphalt, in the amount of $63,227.50. Scott, you're going to be up here for a while, so we'll go down through there and cover probably the next four items, but let's take them one at a time.
Okay. Would it be possible for me to add a state announcement for bid awards?
Sure.
Can I go ahead and cover that?
Sure.
Okay, I'd just like to let y'all know that the state has received bids and awarded the Nebo Mayfield 61 intersection to Baldwin Paving. That is a $2.7 million improvement with turn lanes and a traffic signal. And so we're excited to see some money being spent, state funding in Baldwin County, as well as some progress at that intersection. If you're driving south, that's across from the Route 61 barbecue. And state's already removed that one building across from that location where the kayak and outfitter was located. They've moved up to Hiram City. And so that's all good.
That's good news. That is great news.
I think that's the first intersection we've seen led by the state since maybe the new Georgia 61 intersection. And it's been a four-way stop as an interim project. Well, thank you for letting me announce that.
Absolutely.
First two items are sort of joined. We've had several projects that are urgent up at the North Paulding campus. The first two, Burnt Hickory McClure improvements, that's increasing storage so that we can help get traffic off of the main road where it's very congested on Bob Grogan Road and North Paulding Drive going into those three schools. We took bids back in May for those two small projects and received only one bid. The bid was extremely high and we could not bring that to you for a recommendation. Since that point, we broke the project up into smaller pieces and tried to get more interest from smaller contractors in the area that might be a little hungrier. And we were successful in doing that and we're bringing you those bid awards. There are four pieces. The two smallest pieces were under $50,000. That was for the base and drainage prep out there. That was awarded to Grand Construction. Those were both under 50 from McClure and Burnt Hickory. But the paving and base project, the package of that, which is setting up the pavement structure and the curbing out there, those were over $50,000. We have two bids. We compared the original Blunt Construction bid to a bid submitted by J&W located in Dallas. That resulted in savings of $26,000 on McClure and $35,000 on Burnt Hickory, or vice versa, actually.
Let me go ahead and read two and three, since we're tying all this in together. two, discuss action toward the parking lot addition at McClure Middle School project to the low bidder, J&W Concrete and Asphalt in the amount of $91,850. Number three, discuss action to award to the low bidder, Bartow Paving Company Incorporated, in the amount of $516,601.54 for the Bob Grogan Drive widening exit lane project. So as you're talking about these, you're talking about all three of these.
That's correct. So we were able to attract a little more competition when we rebid it at smaller pieces, and we have bids that we are recommending award today to J&W. You see that item number one and number two. If you have any questions, I'll address the first two.
Just to clarify, all three of them are the same location?
Yes, sir.
We have kind of brought in late. Schools are purchased or land given away, and they build them, and then they kind of create a traffic problem, and then we're brought in. We've been trying to set up monthly meetings with school superintendent, with Scott and I, and then Scott goes to other meetings, trying to get them to get us proactively involved. We found we had a huge problem there when we go back to the ice storm, and a lot of people got trapped in there with one in and one out. The county ends up getting blamed for that, and, you know, we just kind of come in trying to solve problems, so we've taken a more proactive stance. They've had some money they made available to us, is that correct?
That's correct. Back in February, you approved an intergovernment agreement with the school system for $1 million. These are all funded by the school system through that agreement. So no county funds being spent on these projects except for our internal administration costs.
And that don't normally happen, then?
That's highly unusual. It's very forthcoming in the school system to recognize the issue and step forward with that strong funding. And we're pleased to spend it for them and manage it, since it affects so much of our traffic. And it backs up onto the regular road system. And it obviously becomes a county-wide issue when it does that. But cooperatively, since 08, you know, we've been meeting regularly with the school system and planning each site as best we can. There are limitations that they just can't work with us on, and like finding a good site is just difficult. And honestly, they are stuck with choosing locations that are not perfect from a traffic standpoint. If you put a school on a main road, you bog down the main road. If you put it on a back road, well, then you end up spending a lot of money bringing services and utilities and things like that to that location. And this is off of the main road, but yet it's such a large campus that we learned it creates its own traffic congestion problem. That's entirely as a result of the school patterns. And so,
well, we did a preliminary type action where we did some lane changing, and we took down the guard building and stuff out there to make it a little easier. But this should have the traffic problem out there quite a bit.
We're seeing a little bit of improvement with each step, and we hope that continues with these projects. We're rushing to get these done in time for the first week of school, first two bids. Explaining here. The third item, if it's okay if I jump to that, is
absolutely
the exit lane on Bob Grogan Road. That is our county road. You may recall we added a center turn lane back in the spring and made it a three-lane road. This will make it a four-lane road. This will create a lane exiting from McClure Middle all the way out to Harmony Grove Church Road, and will give us a full four lanes into the campus. Up to the intersection, including North Pauling Drive all the way to high school. You will have a four-lane road. That will help us with the exit backup that we see as we're able to speed up the movement of cars into the campus. Then we just find the problem switches to the exiting from the campus, especially for concern with special events and inclement weather and things like that. This is a real important piece of that, adding that extra lane coming out. That will allow the right lane coming off McClure Middle to continue in that right lane all the way to Harmony and turn right to 61 without ever merging. It will allow anybody turning out from the high school or from the elementary to come straight out to Harmony, either make a right turn towards 61 or go back towards Cedar Crest. And we think that will help greatly. We're also working on a traffic signal at the intersection of Bob Grogan and Harmony that we hope to have in place in early fall. Again, that will all work together with what we're doing. Just a little bit about the bid and the contractor. This is are pretty expensive projects that have $1 million. It's a good bit higher. It's, I think we're looking at 10 or 20% higher than what we estimated early. And that's been the trend lately. There's a lot of activity in construction right now. It's been hard to get very aggressive bids. We're fortunate to have two bidders on this and a bid that we feel good. Both bidders were really close, actually, which kind of justifies the low bid. Whereas in the case with a single bidder, like the earlier project, we had nothing to compare it to. So we didn't know if it was just somebody throwing a bid just for the chance they might get it. And we found out it was high. So we're recommending this contract and to award this. This is a little bit longer range project because the time frame to construction is back all the way through May because of culvert work we've got to do. We're actually working with a stream crossing at the entrance to McClure. We have to extend two large culverts that were put in earlier by the school board, and then widen some bills, take out some guardrail. We're also adding sidewalk, which is something we've heard. I'm not sure where they're going, but at the Harmony, we don't have any sidewalk system, but I know the athletic teams and things like that run up and down the road in there. So we're adding sidewalk at least out to Harmony until we see where it needs to go next and get a nice finish look with curb and gutter. Any questions on
the first three items?
Can you say the timetable again, please, Scott?
The first two projects were this summer, by the first week of school. The third project is the exit lane construction. That is a completion date of May. The intent and the stipulations in the contract is that all the pavement will be there so that it can be open to traffic by Christmas break or right after Christmas break, so that there'll be that extra lane will be available, but it may not be final striped or final grassed where we can accept it. So we're trying to get that available to the return for campus after the winter break, or Christmas break, I should say. That's all I have on those three items.
Okay.
Go to number four, if you'd like.
Thank you very much. Number four, discuss action to award the low bidder, CW Matthews Incorporated, in the amount of $1,115,951.74 for the South Main Improvement Project.
Okay, again, we are seeing high prices, but we do have two bidders that are in close proximity to each other. The number two bidder was at $1.172 million, just a little bit higher than the low bid Matthews. We brought you an intergovernment agreement at the last meeting with Dallas, where Dallas is funding $127,000 of this agreement. This will give us a closed drainage system, curb and gutter, and sidewalk from the campus entrance on South Main Street all the way back to the city school, city sidewalk system near the railroad tracks. So that will tie Seaboard's sidewalk that runs to Terry Drummond, as well as the sidewalk that runs all the way back to the downtown area. And we'd seen some inflation. I think we were looking at closer to $500,000 when we were first envisioning this project 5, 6, 7 years ago. This is a bit steep, but in our analysis, it's about 20% higher than our internal estimates. So as soon as we adjust for inflation in our next estimate, we're still seeing more inflation, and as we did with the asphalt contracts. I think this will give us good connectivity. It will tie in and complement with the Veterans Park connection. We are breaking ground on, I think, this week, going back towards Terry Drummond along Highway 278. And that will be a multi-use trail, 8 feet wide. This particular project will be a 6-foot sidewalk with a grass strip set behind the curb. It also includes a small bridge over the drainage area just to the north of our campus. As y'all may have seen, it's flooded at times and didn't have the capacity needed, which is why Dallas has partnered with us on that, so we can improve the capacity at the same time we're building the sidewalk system. This project is also scheduled to be completed in May 2016. It will involve a detour. When they build the bridge next to campus here, there will need to be up to a 2-month detour. So that will be an impact on traffic that we'll have to come back and announce and discuss the detour arrangements with Dallas. Dallas is handling the local detour selection or the routing, and then we're handling the signing. management of our contract. This, also I need to mention, this is splash funded, but because it is tied to the park and is envisioned as a pedestrian project, we do have park funding participating in this in the amount of $500,000. And then DOT roadway splash money participating at $488,000, and then Dallas with the balance.
Thank you.
Any questions?
Any questions?
Outstanding job.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Number five, discuss action to award construction management at-risk contract for Union Park to New South Construction Company, Michael Justice. I want to say thank you for an awesome 4th of July show with us past Saturday night. You did a fabulous job. Band, fireworks, with all your parks folks and the marshals there. I didn't hear of any incident. I do think that we did follow a tag and find a wanted person in there, so we did bring some justice there.
But, yes.
It was all done with donations from various vendors and people that the county did pay for this.
That's correct. 100% funded by sponsorships and vendors.
Thank you.
So completely covered. As you said there, that project takes a lot of help and a lot of cooperation from a lot of different people. The Marshals Department, the Sheriff's Department, the Fire Department. I'm going to leave somebody out there, I know, but there's a lot of county entities involved there, and every member of my staff is there as well. We enjoy doing it. We appreciate you guys coming out for that. And again, it's 100% funded by sponsorships. Chamber of Commerce was the primary sponsor for this past year's event, so we're extremely grateful to them for doing so.
Do you know about how many citizens you had out there?
I think it was down just a little bit. Normally, probably 8,000 to 10,000 people attend. We had one area of one parking lot that wasn't completely filled this time. That's not normally the case. But we also had people that were parked up and down Pine Valley and Graves Lake, you know, that were watching it. So, you know, probably in the neighborhood, 7,000, 7,500 DOT guys. Didn't mean to leave them out, Scott, don't be offended. They put the counters out for us. We'll have a result from them, and we can give you a better number as to what the estimate is when those return.
A lot of folks participating, that's good.
Yes, sir.
When we talk about this CMAR contract for Union Park, you had a committee.
Yes, sir.
You want to talk about the committee that reviewed this park?
Sure. What we did, we modeled this process after the same concept that was used in the selection of the CMAR contractor for the reservoir project. The selection committee consisted of two members of the commission, the finance director, the county engineer, and myself. 17 different firms picked up proposals, the RFPs. Four of those were returned. At that point, those score sheets and proposals, they were evaluated. The score sheets were returned to Troy Engineers. They compiled the scores and came back with the recommendation, which was New South Construction. What this item will do is allow us the opportunity to begin negotiating the guaranteed maximum price. That will come as another agenda item before you, hopefully in the next month and a half or 2 months or so. Hope I'm not speaking out of turn there, guys. What this one will do is only obligates us through that phase to New South Construction. When that other number comes in, we'll be back before you to get that number reviewed and discussed by this board, and then we will move forward from there.
This is a pretty neat concept. You'll have walking trails, you'll have pavilions, there will be a community garden was recommended by Commissioner Mike Pope, and he's agreed to bring his tractor and get the area ready when we finally have the preparation so that people can have, that don't have the facility for a Garden can come, and there's a very similar concept when Dallas Highway, close to the avenues, that Cobb County's done, where they have a community garden there, and it seems to go quite well.
Yes, sir. If I could add one thing, going back to that event on Friday night, just, or Saturday, it was Saturday, they all kind of run together when you're out there for 12, 14 hours. One word of advice to you when you come to an event, if you have a warrant out against you, don't stare the officers down that are telling you where to park. It only raises suspicion, and it doesn't usually work out well for you. So just one word to the wise there for future events.
Thank you.
Yes, sir. Representatives from Troy and New South are here, should you have questions.
You guys want to come up and introduce yourselves so people know who you are? We first, I believe our first project that we ever got exposed in New South was our Veterans Park out front. Quite an awesome job that you've done. And then Troy, we've used them on several engineering projects and done outstanding jobs. So here's a little introduction.
I'm Eddie Wade with Troy. We started on the design process, got through concept phase, and excited to work with New South on this, so we appreciate the project. I think it's a great park. We'll have an internal 5K loop. We'll have a fish pond. It's a beautiful, passive park. I've already walked it several times, so we're excited to see it. So, thank you.
You have pheasant hunting out there, Eddie?
Sounds good to me. Dave Butler, I'm the Vice President of Operations with New South Construction. We are excited to be selected today and recommended, and we really look forward to working with Michael and the entire team to really make this as successful as I hope the Veterans Park was and everything else. We really enjoy working with the county and all the folks here. It's really a great community to be a part of, and so we really appreciate the opportunity to work with you.
You have both Troy and New South both have employees that live here.
We have a number of employees that actually live here in the county, and actually our superintendent lives about 3 miles from the site, so he is really excited. We usually make them drive across town to go from one job to the other, but he's pretty excited about being able to go 3 miles down the road.
So we'll be able to get more work out of him.
That's right. That hour he couldn't be driving each way, we're expecting to be in the job. So.
Any questions for this?
I just like to make a comment that park's at post two, so I'm excited about that. The citizens are excited, and a lot of folks don't realize that years ago that park maybe would have been built, but White Oak came along, the opportunity to purchase White Oak. Commissioner Powell, that was here at the time, said that we needed to, you know, they needed to purchase that park at that time while the getting was good, and I'm glad they did because it's a well-used, great park. But the citizens in Post 2 are looking very forward to that park. We're the only post that doesn't have one of the bigger, newer parks. So I'm excited, and I can't tell you how excited I am to have New South doing it. With the facility that you did out there, the job you did, and that's what I want to see is something done at the end, Michael, that we're not having to go back and fix,
yes, sir,
and take care of. And that's the goal. So thank y'all. I look forward to watching that develop over this next year.
Thank you very much. Appreciate it, Kelly. Reports from committees and departments, Major Leanne Mahone on Animal Control Update.
Good morning.
Good morning.
I just wanted to come before you guys and give you an update on the RFP for privatizing the shelter portion of Animal Control, and also kind of just let you know where we stand with it today. Basically, we had two parties that were interested. We had a group called Lifeline, which you guys may know of. They have a animal services in DeKalb, and also have animal services in Fulton. And then the second group was called Pauling Pet Orphanage. And right before the closing of the RFP, which was May 22nd, we had a meeting at the shelter where we allowed them to come and ask any questions they had to see if they wanted to submit. And one of the things I made it clear was just the fact that our current budget was $730,000, and it would take roughly $250,000 to $260,000 for me to continue running the actual animal control portion of it. So that would leave approximately $470,000 to stay within what our current budget is. Lifeline, on the day of closing, sent me an email saying that they weren't going to submit a proposal because they would require a lot more than $470,000. But we did get a proposal from Paulding Pet Orphanage. And when I got that, I did look it over, and I didn't see a lot of benefit that we would have to Paulding County with it. It wasn't quite where we were wanting to go. We were kind of wanting to do more privatization, not be involved as much. But I wanted some outside input. It's not just mine. Sometimes it's better to have somebody else looking in. So I put a committee together. The committee was myself, Lieutenant Daniel, and Facility Manager Eileen Colerson, who were all highly involved in animal control. And then I selected three folks that I knew would give me some good advice. And we had the Director of Parks and Recs, the Director of Finance, and the Human Resource Specialist. And these three folks, I respect their opinion highly and their outlook on things. And I know for sure that they're not going to tell me just what I want to hear. They'll tell me their honest opinion and be able to go from there. When they came in, they had all the same concerns I did. There's several listed in the email that I had sent, but I'm just going to touch on some of the most important ones that we were requested a denial with. One of them was they requested $525,961. With them requesting that and then me still needing $250,000 to $260,000, it puts us $60,000 over our current budget. So we would be spending more than what our current budget is anyway. Also, this particular 501c3 with Paulding Pet Orphanage only existed for 2 months at the time that the proposal came in. So they came about in March and the proposal closed in May. So we didn't see any benefit or any previous experience where they've run a shelter or been able to handle this type of arm taking. Also, the privatization, the goal was to remove us from it, not to keep us involved in it. And with this particular proposal, we would be still staying highly involved. We wouldn't be saving any money. We would still be they would request that we take their animals to their vet during the day, so we would be involved with shuttling their animals to their vet. We still had maintenance of the building, and then there were equipment issues. They wanted to use a lot of our computers and phones and stuff, which would have to kind of come back into the county because it's county property. So those were some issues. And the last thing that was kind of a big issue was just that they stated that there were other significant expenses that they would be looking at, because they would need additional manpower because the inmate workforce wouldn't be able to go up there anymore. And also there was exterior maintenance that needed to be done that they would have to look at. So overall, what we saw was just the fact that we would be spending more money, we wouldn't be taken out of it. There's a good possibility that there was going to be some more coming back asking for more things. So we decided to deny their request. So with the denial comes, okay, we're still in the same boat, what do we do now? So one of the things that Tabitha, the finance director, suggested, which was a great idea, was that you can still have a group that you have a service agreement with, that you can still provide monetary money to them as long as there's a service agreement. So with that said, our main goal would be to have the animals go to another location to where that specialized group can, you know, rescue. They can do the things they want to do, vaccinate, everything they want to do. We would just send them to them after we have our 3-day hold. So in order to do that, we decided that we needed to do some research, that our big thing would be, let's look at our surrounding counties. We know that most everybody has a shelter in the Humane Society, so how are they doing it? How did it come about? So we researched approximately, we have about 17 and 19 we're doing, but 10 of them we got for sure answers back that we looked at. And most of them had a couple of things in common, and it was, of course, that they all had their own building, all but one. Where the ones we are talking about are listed in a packet I provided to you, but they all had their own buildings, so that was a big deal. And that most of them did not have a county with a contract. There were a few that
did not have what?
A contract with the county, excuse me. So some of them did, but some of them didn't. Most of them got their funding through fundraisers they did, fostering, volunteers, community support, and that kind of thing. But the biggest thing that we took from it was just the fact that they're separate. So apparently that works, and that's definitely the route that we probably need to be taking because it's worked in all these other counties. So at that point, we do have a Paulding Humane Society. They're not as active anymore, but we did speak with the director of it and told her kind of where our plans were, what we're wanting to do, and she was enthusiastic about it, but also hesitant because it's a big job and there's a lot that has to be done. So we knew that we needed to get the word out to the public. After I spoke with you, I wanted to make sure we were good to do that and then get the word out to the public. This community with pets and animals is huge. I mean, they're one of the most generous communities when it comes to providing things that I thought if we could reach out to them and just see what they had to offer, our biggest thing would be a building. The Humane Society is wanting to do that. It could be a building that they can go into their own building and we can help out with so many different things as far as raising money. We could do that service agreement where we send the animals to them, but they get a certain monetary value for doing that for us. And then we're not doing anything besides returning them to owners when we have them. Little things can be done. We've got a project at Animal Control we've raised money from that's completely donation money. And it's about $6,500 with, you know, Humane Society's when we get up and running. The purpose of that money was to help with the runs in the back. Well, of course, that's for the animals. So if that could go to Humane Society, that's obviously something we would think would be a good idea. Another thing is pet licensing. I talked about this about 5 years ago, and it's gotten popular in a lot of other counties. I believe Douglasville does it, Fulton does it. But what that does is it's the groups who use animal control the most are the ones that are pretty much we're going to be dealing with. And what will happen is if, you know, we know who that pet's registered to, when we're out on the road, we can just pick it up and take it straight back to the house. We don't have to bring it to the shelter, and then there's a chance it doesn't get claimed, and then it would go on to the Humane Society. So with pet licensing, and that's a whole lot of money that comes in on that end too. I say a whole lot, but there's just a lot of pets. So it's not a lot for each household. But when that money comes in, you know, that money can always go towards Humane Society also for to help support them on it. But basically, there's a lot we can do as a community to move towards the same goal. And it's worked in other counties, and I think that we're really behind times when you look at a lot of these other counties that are doing it. And it's just something I think we really need to try to do. But there's a lot of work that's got to be done. And I know this is a lot of information, so I'm sure I'm going to get some questions. But if you have any, please.
Any questions?
You got your master's degree in animal control.
I think I did, yeah.
Wow.
Feel like it.
Yeah. Well, you've been working hard for a long time, Ms. Mahone, and we appreciate it.
Yeah, we do.
What's the cost to license a pet in some of these other counties?
You pick your fee. And the best thing about the pet licensing is there's a group called Pet Data, and I put some information in your packet on it. They actually do all the work. They make sure that the pet's vaccinated, so they'll contact the vets even. They do all the work for it. They even send out the licensing. They contact the people. And we determine what that fee is. So, like, a lot of places, what they'll do is they'll have a higher fee if the animal is not spayed. So, like, in our case, I think my suggestion was, like, it'd be $25 if it's not spay or neutered. If it is spay or neutered, then the licensing fee is only $10. And what happens is Pet Data, I believe they take $3.90 from it, and then they give us the rest of the money. So we're not even doing any work. They're doing it all, and then they keep their $3.90 on whatever amount we do. I mean, you could say we're only going to charge, you know, $5 or whatever. You can make up whatever fee you want on it. There's some counties that will make it, you know, high and really do well with it, and other counties that don't. On the flip side of it would help with us being able to return the animal to where it needs to be and us not have to put it in the system, which is half the problem right now anyway.
I know no one in this room would ever not license their pet, but just people that aren't here, is there a citation to find it?
Yeah, and if you think about it, it would be an ordinance that would say you have to license your pet, but if we're not dealing with your pet, we don't know if it's licensed or not, because you're not going to houses saying, let me see if you got a pet license. You know, the main thing would be when we go out, we've got a dog running down the road, we're now having to deal with the animal of a pet, of an owner that's maybe not being so responsible. And it happens, sometimes they just get out, but sometimes we have a lot of repeats that just let them roam free. But they're the ones that we would actually be overseeing whether they have the license or not. The other ones were not, we have no reason to go to the house and say, let me check your dog license or cat license.
Two more questions. On your committee that denied the proposal, that was 100% no, right?
Yes, sir, and, you know, we sat there saying, let's just get some pros out of this, honest pros, and we really couldn't get any pros out of it as far as where we were trying to go. But the big thing was to privatize, and we were still highly involved.
What will you have to license your chickens?
We're not talking about chickens right now. Please don't make me license chickens.
Well, this wasn't part of the brief, but since constituents have asked me about why we aren't vaccinating, some of the things you and I have talked about on the side.
Yes,
would you take a couple of minutes just to explain the situation in our facility?
Right. Our facility is extremely old. It's been there a while, and when it was originally built, everything's one gigantic room. The ventilation's connected. There's never a room in that building that's isolated. We do have a shed out back. That's the puppy room. And if a lot of you know something about animals, puppies get parvo quite a bit. And when you get a parvo case, it has to be isolated. Well, if you have a little room like that where they go, then you're not having to quarantine the entire building. So if you can just quarantine a little room where it's likely that they're going to have something at some point, then we can do that. So that's the only isolated room we have. So if we get something like kennel cough or something of that nature that spreads airborne, then all of our ventilation is connected. So when we try to give them some medication, it doesn't matter because they're still breathing to the other areas in the kennel. Vaccinations, they take 2 to 5 days to take effect, sometimes up to 14. And if we have an animal that comes in and they're perfectly healthy, we give them a vaccination. You know, it takes 2 to 5 days to work. There could be an animal that comes in right behind them because we get animals daily. We get a lot of animals daily. So if that animal comes in behind them and is sick, but this one's had the vaccination already, it's within that 2 to 5 days, it doesn't matter, it's now getting sick because that vaccination hasn't taken effect yet. And then you can go vice versa. The animal could come in sick, you can give them a vaccination, it's not going to cure them or do anything. So in a South Pole states, but you're kind of wasting money to give the vaccination because it's not really working in our environment. If we had an area, like if our shelter was the kind that you had a secluded area that when an animal comes in, you put them in a secluded area for X amount of days to be able to see if they have something or not, that would probably help the rest of the shelter, but our facility is not equipped for that. If we can move more towards Humane Society and get them a building set up like that, we can get out of that aspect of animal control and give that to the folks that they specialize in that kind of thing and vaccinating and getting them to rescues and fostering. And we're good on the, you know, let me make sure you keep your dog up and that you're not, you know, doing any animal cruelty issues.
I'd just like to say thanks for all your work. I know we see the emails, a lot of citizen calls. And I'd like to also thank Commissioner Carmichael for your work. I know you put a lot of time and effort into it, so thank you. Hopefully we can just continue the conversation and move forward and ease our way into some different things in the future. So thank you.
Let's open up just a very quick dialogue. You Sheriff's Department, 911, since fireworks have complete, has had a tremendous increase in 911 calls and sheriff calls. And you proposed to me to look at something maybe on our next agenda about firecracker noise and maybe stopping that at 10 o'clock when you've got other ordinances that come in loud music.
Right.
You want to address that for a quick second?
Yeah, we've had the new state law changed, and Sheriff may want to help out on this one, he's been dealing with it, but the state law changed to where they can shoot fireworks off until midnight. And then, except on July 3rd and 4th, it can go till 2 a.m. Well, the fireworks went on from July 3rd and 4th through Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, and they just kept going around. So we have a noise ordinance, but our noise ordinance is specific. You know, there's a section that talks about loud music, radios, loud voices, horn. It has to be specific in it. So the ordinance doesn't really cover that because we're not being specific in it. So we'd like to put a little, extra little part in there saying about making it till 10 a.m., except maybe on like a holiday, that it could go till later.
Yeah, that, what Sheriff College is telling us about what I'm about to say.
But you can be more strict.
No, you can't. It's the opposite. The state law preempts the county ordinance, so we cannot be more strict.
That was ordinance would not take this, and I was getting a lot of gifts to help with the state law. That the one the state tells us how to run our own community.
Right, the state law, we can't preempt the state law, so if the state law has ours in it, we can't be more restrictive than those.
I think they're looking to tighten this up some, and I know. Michael Justice brought to my attention that you can go into parks and also set off fireworks, which they weren't aware that they allowed that. So I see that changing from here.
If it's out there, phones are gonna keep ringing.
I think it'll change soon, and all I know is over that weekend, I'll be ready for everybody to run out of money.
It won't change the legislation, because the bank decision, so we're looking at next year.
Correct. It won't change one.
It won't change the legislation, goes back in session to change the law, if they change the law. And that's changing.
Vernon has a pet question.
Yeah, I can do that. For fishing fireworks, I'm gonna give that. On those counties that have a pet license, is it always mandatory, or some of those counties leave it open to, you know, if you want to do it, you can?
It's an ordinance, so.
So it's always mandatory. And then second, last time you and I talked, you mentioned something about Hope County Co-op. I didn't hear you mention that. Can you give me an update on that, if it's totally out now?
That was kind of Plan B. I would love for us to have our own stuff here, if we can do that. If for some reason that we can't get it up and going here in Talley County, you know, like the Drug Task Force, they have like Paul Carroll's and they join together to help out. It'd kind of be a similar thing that we would like to do with the surrounding county. Polk County was one that we talked about because they're in a similar situation. They don't have a Humane Society, and they're in a situation where they have the Humane Society in the same building with them, and that they're trying to separate out. So if, you know, if we couldn't get our own thing going, then one of the things that we thought about from Plan B would be maybe we could partner with them and allow both entities to go into one. Probably a little bit difficult to know what the amount of animals would be, or how that would work, but it's definitely a Plan B.
Would it help if we got Pauline Pet Ordinance talking with the Humane Society and maybe they together come up with something?
Yeah, absolutely. Any group, and that's what the best thing about the animal community is, we have people calling us constantly, whether it's a group, an individual, a family, that are constantly wanting to donate things. We have people that want to do monetary things, people want to donate food or blankets, and then other people want to volunteer time. So if we can get, that's why we want to reach out to the community to get them all to come together to do that in one place instead of it kind of being all over, then I'm almost positive we can make it work.
Do you have plans to reach out to the community?
Yes, sir. Well, there's a letter in your folder. We're definitely going to get out to all social media and the newspapers and so forth, and definitely the shelter. So we need to have some meeting probably in the future, just for people who are interested and want to come just ask questions and get it out there. So.
In the past, I know you've had a big day out there, shelter, and you've had vendors come in and that type of thing. So that's one of the things you're continuing.
Yeah, and that's fundraising. You know, we wouldn't necessarily have to do that as much as what Humane Society would, but we're all about helping them out. They'd be giving us a huge service with helping us with the animals. So whatever we can do to help them would be fantastic.
Right. Thank you.
Thank you for your work.
Thank you. Public participation on agenda items. We have Kathy Helms, 191 Oval Road, Rockmart, Georgia. New business item number 2.
Good morning.
Good morning.
I have some concerns about the selling alcohol at Veterans Park. I am not against people consuming alcoholic beverages. But when we open that door for that park, we're going to open the door for all the other parks in the county. If they, what if somebody wants to do an event down at Holly Meadows or at Taylor Farm or, you know, at one of the other county parks? If you approve this, how can you deny something in the future? That's all I want to say. And I want to add one more thing. I was a little disappointed because I didn't see that Blake was on the agenda today. I didn't see that on Thursday. I don't know when that was added. But I certainly wish I could have seen that because I had tons of questions I wish that I could have had my commissioner ask.
Lynn Berlini, Berlini Indian Lake Court, Ireland. Your business hours number two.
Thank you for allowing me to speak. We have been touting Veterans Park as a family-friendly park. Selling alcohol in a family-friendly park is extremely diametrically opposed to one another. Having a concert is great. If you choose to have the marshals and sheriffs look the other way for brown bagging, like Stone Mountain and other parks do, that's great. The sale of alcohol in a family-friendly atmosphere is not the way we should go.
Consent agenda, discuss action on two consent agenda items. Number one, adopt resolution 15-17 supporting the designation of proposed United States Bicycle Route, USBR 21, through Baldwin County. Ann, if you come to the lecture for a quick second, pretty self-explanatory what we want to do, but it's just a designation.
Yes, good morning, commissioners, and thank you.
Good morning.
The Georgia Department of Transportation approached me about this. They are working with the National Corridor Plan, which is a nationwide designation of bike routes. The first bike route in Georgia is this U.S. Bike Route 21, and it goes from the Atlanta Beltline through Chattanooga and utilizing the Silver Comet Trail, and they have asked for Paulding County to support this since the trail goes through our county.
This is probably one of our, I guess, our number one tourist attraction in the county, and it makes sense to me, but I felt like the commission needed to get there.
Yeah, there was a study done several years ago, and they estimated about 665,000 people access the trail on the three Paulding County locations. And that study also estimated that the average trail visitor spends $50 a visit. So this is a huge asset to the county and is a big part of getting tourism to draw to the county.
Fantastic. Thank you. I guess going hand in hand with that is when you have a local splash, then it helps people visiting our county help pay for some of our roads and our sheriff's department and those type of things. So that's good. Number two, discuss action to consider the request for a special event permit for the sale and consumption of alcohol at Veterans Park. Oh, I'm sorry. Number two. Acquisition to the Sheriff's Office to oversee the inmate detail for Collin County Parks. Michael?
For the last probably 10 or 12 years, we have had a contract with the Georgia Department of Corrections for an inmate work detail out of their prison at off Industrial Boulevard. They are closing that workforce down, and I think some sort of drug rehab facility is going there, and that would leave us with the option of contracting again with the Georgia Department of Corrections through their facility in Rome, Georgia. The amount that we have paid for the, you know, that contract has never been more than $38,000 to this point, and that gives us a workforce of anywhere from 6 to 8 inmates a day. And we basically pay the guard salary and furnishing the vans and the equipment for them to operate with.
It's a huge multiplier.
It pretty much doubles our current parks maintenance staff. So it is a
big plus for us to have it. Going through Rome under this new contract, that amount raises from $38,000 to $62,000. It does not take into account any maintenance costs for the vehicle, coming back and forth to Rome twice a day, the time that it would take to get them here, and the time that it would take for them to leave, you know, away from the job, and the fuel costs for those trips. When we approached Tabitha about that, and she in turn had conversations with Sheriff Village and Major Hunt with the Sheriff's Department, and they can hire a deputy for a little bit less than that amount and provide that service for us. So that's what this agenda item is addressing this morning.
Any questions?
Sheriff, no.
Still seems like to me that, you know, still gives you that multiplier effect. What causes that to make that change?
The state did it. The state did it. They decided to change directions with the facility that they have there currently. They're no longer using work details out there.
Okay.
Every inmate that's assigned there stays there for some sort of a treatment or rehab program now.
Okay. Thank you.
Yes, sir.
No old business under new business. Discuss action to adopt resolution 15-18, amending ordinance 7053, approving speed limits and approving the use of speed detection devices on certain county roads.
This comes to us from the state. It's just involving state routes this time. We last updated the county system and state route system in 2012. And specifically, this request involves changes on US 278, where the 45 zone through Hiram is being expanded, and 55 zone through Dallas is being expanded further west, out to the city limits of Mount Olivet. I think the last time they really did a comprehensive change on 278 was when we had three traffic lights, if that gives you an idea. So I think it's due. The city, I understand, supports lowering the speed limit through the congested area in Hiram. That will push the 45 zone almost to the county line on the east end, and it will the 45 zone will end between Westside Bank and Wellstar Hospital. Dallas has also tried to get the speed limit lowered from 65 to 55 or lower, and they were successful in having this reviewed and revised. So it was supported by the cities. Just a tiny part of that involves the county jurisdiction. This also gives authority for the sheriff, as well as state patrol. I think they have authority regardless, but the police officers and sheriff can use detection devices on either the radar or laser in these zones. It doesn't matter where the jurisdiction is, they tend to police their own jurisdictions more frequently. There is a slight tweak on Highway 101, the Union School Zone, was shifted about 2 or 3 tenths of a mile in direction, or just cleaned up, I'm not sure. It's not a significant change either way. There is no change to this, the county road list this time. We are working on a comprehensive county road update. Hopefully bring that to you within a year, and then submit that to the state for their approval, and then we'll come back with an ordinance update. There's several roads that need to be updated, I realize that. It is a long process. It requires an engineering study to validate these speed zones so that the use of detection devices is considered appropriate and the speed limits are appropriate. So we support this change and request your approval.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Number two, discuss action to consider the request for a special event permit for the sale of consumption of alcohol at Veterans Park by the City of Dallas on August 7, 2015, for an event entitled 38 Special Concert in accordance with 6-91 of the Code of Ordinances. Michael brought this to me a while back. We looked at it and felt like we need to bring it before the commission for a vote. It's a request by the City of Dallas that are funding this concert. And I think this is similar to what they do in the City of Marietta, also City of Ackworth and City of Kennesaw, and it works in a controlled environment. Whether we decide to do it or not is up to this board, but explain to us where the request came from.
Yes, sir. Been a bit way more than I'm comfortable with today. With the construction of the Veterans Park became opportunities for items that, such as you're looking at. Now, the current ordinance, to address the concerns a little bit earlier, kind of two parts in there. One of those prohibits alcohol in any county park. There's another section in there, 691, that would allow it for special events under the approval of the county administrator, which we do not have. And that's why it's in front of you now. It is on the application process, that, or on the application itself, that it can be requested at this point, depending on your actions and your wishes. If you wanted to change or remove that, then we would either remove it from the application entirely, or we bring it to you every time there is such request. This is from an outside entity. It is from the city of Dallas. It is not from the county parks and recreation department. I don't foresee bringing any from our department to you. You know, as I said, it states now that there is none allowed. It is allowed under special event provisions by approval of the county administrator in his absence of board commissioners. This is for concert August the 7th that they have leased the facility for that night.
Lynn and I were talking about this before the meeting. Mike, what would be some examples over in Cobb County and Marietta?
I think Glover Park, their summer concert series that they do there, they're in a little bit different situation there because they are surrounded by several restaurants and bars, if you will. They are permitted to sell alcohol outside their place of business when those types of events are taking place. That's the only example that I can think of to bring to you.
I know Atworth Beach, that they allowed tables to be sold and alcohol sales there are provided by the table they're selling. So,
yes, sir.
Those are the only ones I know.
Do you have any background on the history, how it got in our ordinance? This 691, I read over last night also.
No, sir. I really don't. I know that the other provision has been there as long as I have been here. That's been quite a while. The other one may have been here as well. It's there, and that's why it's in front of you today.
I think if this board would wish to, I think that's something we need to look at because I don't feel like that any one person should make that decision on somebody coming into our county parks and being able to do that or not. And maybe that's something we need to look at another time because I don't think that's the right route to go as far as that's concerned. Because we're the ones who's going to have to answer to it. And points were made. I think the city of Marietta, that's a little different situation. We've got restaurants and different things. We've actually built a Veterans Park right here for our citizens. It's actually on this complex in our beside our court system. And I'm not in favor of doing that. I'm not in favor of opening that door.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Yes, sir.
Thank you.
That's a conclusion. Before we go on, I would like to make a motion to add one thing to new business just for a couple minutes of discussion concerning the FAA letters. Not a huge discussion, but this one. I would like to make a motion that we add that to this agenda to discuss this just for a couple minutes.
Second. There's a motion. Second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Carries 5-0.
I wanted to bring this up. There was a couple of letters written from the FAA June 30th of last month. One of them was to Calvin Thompson, and it was copied, one of the people was copied on it was Mr. Austin. Chairman Austin. The other one was written to Chairman Austin, and one of the folks that was copied was Captain Thompson. The reason that I wanted to bring up the FAA letters that were written, which is now 15 days ago, because the FAA is asking for a legal opinion from the Board of Commissioners, and then the FAA says that if we respond, if the Board of Commissioners responds, that they will then give the Airport Authority an opportunity to respond. So I'm bringing this up because I'm a little disappointed that our resolution that we did the first of the year, that it took the FAA almost 6 months to respond to us. That was a long time to take to respond, and then to give us the response that they gave us in the letters. These letters are part open records. We've had some citizens ask for them, so you're more than welcome to continue to ask for those letters so that you can read them for yourself. But the response that they gave us, it's a little disappointing that it took that long to get that response. I would have felt like once we got a response, it would have been more to it. So the reason that I'm asking to put it under new business is I would like, it's asking for a response from us. I would like to basically have a letter drawn up from our county attorney, Skipper, that would go out tomorrow to the FAA that would let them know that they will be getting a response from us very soon, somewhat soon, and we will not take 6 months to get that response to them like they took 6 months to get it to us. I understand sometimes government can be slow, but I want them to know, I want them to hear from this Board of Commissioners, from our legal counsel, that they will be getting a letter from us, and they will be getting that letter from us in the near future. That way we've got time to respond to it, and they know that it's coming, because the letter from them is very clear that if we respond, so I don't know how long that if would be that they would take it that we didn't respond. So I want them to know that it's coming. So that's basically what it is. I would like for us to do that however y'all would see fit. I don't mind us just voting if we get the county attorney to send that letter to them. But I would like to put on the agenda that we send that letter to them tomorrow. The county attorney would draw that up and get it to us for our review, and then us give her the okay to go ahead and send that letter. And I guess that's all I've got to say.
Okay. That's the conclusion of our regular business session. We have executive session for real estate and litigation. I need a motion to go into executive session.
Mr. Chairman, I'd like to make a motion to go into office funds.
For real estate, litigation, and personnel. We don't have any citizens wishing to speak. This could be lengthy. So we'll dismiss, and then once we get through closed session, we'll come back in. The meeting at that point will be over. If you want to stay, you're welcome to stay. But we will be in, I think, probably a lengthy real estate litigation of personnel. Do I hear a motion?
I make a motion.
Second. Pro second. Any discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Carries 5-0. And we will return. I'm not going to say shortly. Probably not be short.
Had two parts to the executive session. Chairman Austin had to go be with the Department of Agriculture personnel So that's where he is now, and he asked me to preside over the rest of the meeting, so.
You should put on the record that no official action was taken, and so we don't have any items from closed session to place on the agenda except the resolution tonight. And now we need a motion to adjourn.
Make a motion. Will you adjourn?
Second.
All those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Thank you, gentlemen.
See?
See you later.
An hour.
We got an hour.
Yeah, there is.
What don't get me a hamburger?